about a half degree Celsius, making the 20th century as warm as any in 600 years. The 10 warmest years of the century have occurred in the last 15. And there are other signals as well. In Glacier Bay National Park in Alaska, many of the land-based glaciers are receding. Most glaciers are shrinking also in Argentina, the Alps, the Himalayas, and New Zealand. Also in Alaska, in the Sierra Nevada and along Mount Kilimanjaro, plants are moving to higher and higher elevations. Skeptics have argued that such changes are just a factor of climate variability, that there is no proof that the heating of the Earth has been caused by greenhouse gases. But in 1995, a United Nations panel of leading scientists found evidence of a discernible human influence on global climate. And the issue took center stage.
We must work to reduce harmful greenhouse gas emissions. These gases released by cars and power plants and burning forests affect our health and our climate. They are literally warming our planet. If they continue unabated, the consequences will be nothing short of devastating for the children here in this audience and their children.
But despite the proclamations of scientists and politicians, for many, the best evidence of climate change is found in the record number of so-called extreme weather events that have been shaking the world in recent years. Tens of thousands of acres of forest burn in California during a severe drought. In the Midwest, the flood of the century devastates 9 states bordering the Mississippi. In China, scorching heat and drought cripples the southern provinces. Flooding in Bangkok brings water to the highest level ever recorded. One group becoming convinced by such events is the insurance industry.
If you look at the last 30 years of trends in payouts for insurance claims due to natural disasters on a global scale, we find that in the early 1960s, the average payout was about $1 billion per year. We find that in the 1990 to 94 period, we were paying out an average of almost $45 billion per year. That's $1 billion a week rather than $1 billion a year. And they are saying we can't risk that this is climate change, because if it is, this is just the tip of the iceberg. It's going to get worse.
Along the northern coast of Trinidad are mountains that drop off suddenly to magnificent beaches. This end of the island is known for its picture postcard beauty, offering the kind of Caribbean image that draws more than 200,000 tourists each year. But as you travel to the southern end of the island, the scenery becomes very different. This is the industrial section of Trinidad, home to oil refineries and petrochemical plants. What is obvious as you travel from one end of the island to the other is that its most valuable economic resources, a beach for tourists and large industrial plants, are located right along the coast. If the sea level rises as predicted, it seems that Trinidad will have a lot to lose. Over the last 100 years, global sea level has risen about 4 to 10 inches. It's predicted to rise now at an accelerated rate, increasing by about another 19 inches over the next century. But it's very difficult for islands to assess their vulnerability to such a rise because frightening predictions about global sea level have to be put into context.
It really depends on the site that you're talking about. Some islands are sinking naturally, so sea level rise would be worse because they're sinking, plus you'd have the rise associated with global change. And some islands are rising out of the ocean, and they may not have any relative sea level change at all. See, it's a change of the sea level relative to the land that's of importance in terms of the socioeconomic impact.
The challenge then is for islands to determine on a site-by-site basis what the impact of climate change could be. And Trinidad is just beginning to find resources to do that. Victoria Mendez-Charles is with the Ministry of Planning and Development.
And we are indeed participating in a regional project on planning for adaptation to climate change, for which we have got funding, and which is to start this year, 1997. And this project will indeed focus attention on data collection and also installation of equipment, some of the infrastructure that we require for data collection.
I was here, John, you're in.
In its effort to monitor climate changes, Trinidad has an ally in Bawan Singh. These days, he is spending much of his time on a small peninsula on the southwestern corner of the island called Ikakos Point. There are no resorts for tourists here, no multinational industries. There's just a small fishing village where close to 500 people eke a living out of the sea.
6 glass enter.
At the local school, global warming and climate change are not yet parts of the science curriculum. And yet the residents of Ikakos may know better than many what to expect when the earth warms. Because just as it is on the eastern shore, the sea is reclaiming the land. A few years ago, the owners of a coconut oil plantation put up a wall in a desperate attempt to hold back the sea. For Singh, that wall is now an important indicator of how fast the sea is rising.
It's stable. We didn't see much damage here the last time.
All right.
But since they put in this wall here, things seem to have at least slowed down a bit.
Singh last made his measurements at Ikakos Point 12 months ago. Clearly, a lot can happen in a year.
Hey, what happened? Look at the wall. Oh, my gosh.
Oh, no, it seems
there's a dynamic wave there.
Oh, my.
I wonder if this was one specific event or...
Oh my God, look what the hell happened.
Because I remember at least the last...
What happened? Look at this. Is the benchmark still here?
I think there is another sign of it.
At least the benchmark is here. Oh my gosh, we got to have to start a whole new profile here. Look at that damage.
Huh. This has happened within the last year.
We were here last year to the date, last January.
Yeah.
And the wall was like it is over there. This is incredible.
The wall was not strongly reinforced. It reflects the limited resources a place like Ikakos has for dealing with a problem like this. But it was concrete, 2 feet thick.
Look at the damage to the wall. This is incredible. This tree was up the last time, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yes,
it was.
This is gone. We're going to lose this guy pretty soon.
The struggle to hold back the sea has been underway here for at least 10 years.
Remember they had put groins in last year?
The groins are all removed.
Yeah,
right,
to hold back the water. They're all gone.
They're all gone, right?
Yeah, the jetty that was here, the little jetty going out. Oh my gosh, look at that house.
Over the last few decades at Ikakos, much more than a wall has been lost.
So all this was land around here?
All this was land.
Unbelievable.
Dee Kanju was born here 60 years ago and has watched the point literally disappear.
So that was land all the way there?
Yeah, all the way.
And there.
And we have land put out again.
So how deep is that out now?
Huh?
That, how deep would that
That's
be?
About 8 feet or 8 or 9 feet.
So it's now 8 feet underwater.
Yeah, underwater.
And it was above land 40 years ago?
40 years. No, I wouldn't say that's 40 years ago, you know.
How long?
This is about 10 years now, you know.
10 years?
Yeah, about 10
years.
That's about 10 years now.
It's difficult to believe that the area now being used by fishing boats was once a cricket field. A playing area about the size of an average baseball field. And just beyond the field, there was the village cemetery. But the most amazing story the residents of Ikakos tell is that there's a lighthouse out there under the water.
I used to go and play little marble hunting right on the lighthouse. Yeah, my father and him used to pull up boat all in front of the lighthouse.
Was it pretty?
Yeah, nice. Always painted white.
with a red top.
The story of the light fall was told differently by each person asked. Some people said it had fallen over.
So it fell over.
Others said you could see the top at low tide. At first, it seemed impossible to find, but then...
Standing on it?
Yeah.
There's a very strong current, and the visibility isn't very good, but I wanted to see the light pole for myself. I found it encrusted with shells, completely submerged, and this is low tide? How much more will the sea take?
Next 10 years, it might reach by my house. I mean, I might pass away that time.
Mm-hmm.
But you're going to cut story if there is no stop.
The people here have no explanation for their problems with the sea, and there's just one way to determine the cause, by making the measurements and tediously recording the data.
We have to note that this is a completely new profile. At least our benchmark is still here. Because even the spike we had put in was more or less flush with the ground. And now it's about 8 inches of it exposed.
Right.
Together with the roots of the trees.
A basic rule about sea level rise is that for every centimeter of sea rise, the shoreline will retreat about a meter.
1.798.
According to Singh's measurements, Ikakos has lost much more land that could be accounted for by the predicted sea level rise. It seems there's something else going on here that would only be made worse by a rapidly rising sea. Bawan Singh and his crew, in pursuit of indicators of global warming, are grappling with the central problem of detecting climate change. They're trying to sort out what scientists call noise, all the other factors that could be contributing to a problem besides global warming.
That's as far as we could go. We have to note that wall collapse.
The problems at Ikakos could be caused by the Orinoco River in Venezuela, which empties into the ocean a few miles from Trinidad. As the forests along the Orinoco have been cut down, more and more soil has eroded into the river, increasing the load of sediment that the river is discharging into the ocean.
You know, you're talking about several million tons of sediments per year. And this could cause a certain amount of pressure on the basin or the bed of the sea that could cause a certain deformation and subsidence in certain areas.
It is one theory. Another has to do with Trinidad's most valuable economic resource, oil. In the mid-1800s, the first oil well was drilled on the island near here, where the evidence of the black gold was obvious. This is called Pitch Lake. It's an enormous natural deposit of a petroleum residue, liquid asphalt.
There's a lake in France, it's not like this one. There's a lake in Brazil, it's not like this one. There's a lake in Norway.
Visitors to Pitch Lake are always accompanied by eager guides who make a small living, showing off what they considered to be one of the great wonders of the world.
If he stand up, he's going to disappear.
If he stays in one place, he would sink down.
He would sink down.
Oh, yeah. Look at that. There he goes. Whoa! But it's not like quicksand that gets all around. Wow, look at that. Look at that.
There are a few other asphalt lakes in the world, but this one is the largest, 115 acres. At its deepest point, it is more than 130 feet deep.
It's called the mother of the lake.
Uh-huh. Now, what, he pushed that under. Now he's going to pull it up.
With something unusual on it.
What could it be?
Liquid pitch.
Wow, there it is. Look at that, a curtain of an oily substance.
The mud of the lake is quite fair softer than the hard stuff, and it also feeds the hard stuff.
Uh-huh.
It contains of 60% of natural gas and 40% of natural sulfur.
Wow.
That's why called liquid pitch.
Liquid pitch.
Today, the asphalt is mined and shipped around the world for use in roads, runways, roofing.
Liquid pitch.
Over the last 100 years, the oil beneath the island that formed Pitch Lake has made Trinidad one of the richest Caribbean nations. But it's come with a price. Oil spills have polluted the waters of the island. There are concerns about pollution from the refining of oil. And now it's theorized that the erosion problems at Ikakus Point and Manzanilla Bay could be blamed in part on the drilling for oil. Surrounding the island on the southern and eastern shores are fields of oil rigs. And the speculation is that as the oil is extracted from the ground is sinking.
It could have been the petroleum industry, because remember, you're removing material from under the ground, whether it be the bottom of the ocean or the land. And it's obvious, if you were to take any that material out, you'd essentially create a vacuum, and the land would sort of subside to compensate for it.
If the problems along Trinidad's shores are not caused entirely by sea level rise, resulting from an enhanced greenhouse effect, they do offer an image of what the island could expect if the predictions of the computer models are accurate. And for Bawan Singh, that is half the battle, getting people to at least think about what might happen. Because as he looks around the island, what he sees are expensive houses and high-rise condominiums built right up against the coast.
These houses are being built in reclaimed land, land that was under the sea at one stage, and they were filled up, and people are building, investing millions of dollars. And you mentioned the question of a sea level rise to them, or it doesn't register. Oh, that's nothing that's going to affect me, at least not in my lifetime. I mean, this is how they look at it. And there aren't any what we call setback limits.
Part of the problem is the uncertainty that still exists about the predictions of climate computer models. Dave McIntosh is acting director of Trinidad's Environmental Management Authority.
I think we need to have real data and real measurements to give us a clear indication. I think we are, for all intents and purposes, speculating because of the complexity of those models. To think that they will mimic reality, I think they will give us some idea of the trends, but without the hard data where you are measuring and actually seeing sea level rising, I think it would be difficult for us to take the issue seriously.
Getting people to take the issue seriously is also accomplished by showing them how much of their world could be changed. And Trinidad's potential problems with climate change go well beyond eroding beaches. This is the Carony Swamp, 12,000 acres of tidal lagoons, marshland, and mangrove forests. It's an estuary, connected to the ocean by various channels, where salt water mixes with fresh water under the influence of the ocean tides. Bawan Singh believes it's another piece of Trinidad threatened by the prospect of climate change.
This is along the Blue River estuary. And the hypothesis is that if sea level were to be rising, you should be able to observe a progressive push inland of this, that tongue of salt water, oceanic water.
For 3 years, Singh has measured the salinity and temperature at 11 sites along one channel in the swamp.
See, this is not changing much, so right. this I would imagine will already the ocean water that has actually displaced
2 meters.
2 meters. Yeah. You see, it's still at 28.6.
Now so that doesn't change, which means it's all ocean water.
That's
it's
right.
Salt water.
That has reached this point. Okay, what are we at? There's 6 meters, Conrad.
Yeah, 6 meters. Uh-huh.
You have 18 feet
bottom.
Of water here.
Uh-huh.
I think it's even more here.
And it's. Well, it's all
that's right.
Ocean water.
I would say it's essentially ocean water. Based on my limited data set, it seems that I detect, this tongue of salt water, oceanic water, is pushing further and further inland with time over the last 3 years.
So this is a gauge or a signal?
That's right.
The increasing intrusion of salt water into the swamp threatens the plants here. Mangroves can tolerate salt water, but they need fresh water to survive. But also threatened by sea level rise is the wildlife of the swamp, and one resident in particular. the scarlet ibis. It's related to the sacred ibis that was worshipped in ancient Egypt for its legendary powers. At low tide, it's feeding time for the scarlet ibis. Their long legs are perfect for wading into the shallow water. Their slender beaks enable them to reach crabs deep in the mud. But if the sea rises, these mudflats could disappear.
These mudflats are precariously, I would say about a foot at most, above this low tide level. Historically, these mangrove swamps have been able to keep up with sea level rise by building up sediments as the sea level rose over the last 100 years or so. But if we're talking now accelerated sea level rise, 6 times or up to 10 times higher than the current rate. Now, if that were to be the case and the level of the sea were to rise so fast, what would happen with time is that these mudflats might not be exposed even at low tide.
It's easy to look at this picture and understand that a rapidly rising sea could spell trouble for the birds dependent on these feeding grounds. But there are still more threats to this beautiful marsh. Long before anyone considered the consequences of global warming, the Kerani Swamp was badly polluted by industries discharging into the watershed, a problem familiar to other parts of the island as well.
The environmental issues in Trinidad are tremendous. As you can well imagine, a fairly industrialized country, an oil producer, a country with a very large petrochemical sector, there's an enormous amount of pollution. The green issues, the conservation issues, as you can see, we have a very beautiful country with a great biodiversity, and we need to protect that. Okay, go down one more.
As people in Trinidad work to solve environmental problems created on their own shores, they know they'll need time to respond to the threat of problems created largely by more industrialized countries. In the meantime, as people consider the possible consequences of climate change, one not usually on the list is the loss of this spectacular sight. Every evening at dusk, thousands of scarlet ibis come home to roost. They arrive from all directions in what has been called the flying sunset. In a world that is warming, every living thing could be affected. And if you ask anyone in the Caribbean what they worry about most from climate change, they almost always mention their coral reefs. Reefs protect the islands from storms. They provide food for island nations. And they are beautiful, drawing hundreds of tourists who come to see the magnificence of underwater life. But in recent years, a sickness has been plaguing coral reefs around the world, known as bleaching. When colorful algae that live in the corals die, turning the coral ghostly white. Because the corals depend on the algae as a source of energy, often the corals die as well. The increasing number of bleaching events in recent years has stunned scientists like University of Miami biologist Peter Glynn.
The 82-83 bleaching event in the eastern Pacific was followed by a serious event in 1987 in the Caribbean, and subsequently from about 1988 to the present time, there are bleaching events occurring worldwide in all of the major coral reef ocean areas, perhaps as many as 8 or 10 events per year, and this seems to be unprecedented.
In laboratory studies, Glynn and colleagues have found that it takes an increase in water temperature of about 1 to 2 degrees Celsius to cause corals to bleach, raising the possibility that global warming may play a role in coral bleaching.
Most of the large-scale bleaching events that we observe now are in areas where there are significant positive temperature anomalies. That is, over extended periods, the sea temperatures are warmer than normal.
With suspicions about bleaching and a warming ocean, Bhawan Singh has come to Trinidad's sister island, Tobago, to continue his search for signals of climate change.
And also on the reef, you have like this dead.
These are dead coral.
Dead. We have dead coral.
Right.
And mixed with the living ones.
So what we're looking for is a bleach that would make the whole thing very white. White is that, translucent white.
Because Singh is not a scuba diver, he has enlisted the help of Tony Thomas, a local diver, in making an assessment of the reefs around Tobago. Okay,
so this is what we're going after then.
Right, this
But with more white in it.
More white in it.
More extensive white. All right.
We're heading for Speyside, a popular north side reef where Tony has seen some changes.
This is where the sighting of the bleaching is.
As usual, Singh will make his measurements, getting one more piece for the complicated puzzle he's assembling.
So when I go back, we get the satellite data. So this is like ground truthing the satellite data for water temperature. Right now we're seeing it's about 27 degrees Celsius, which for at the surface and down to about 10 meters, which for this is January, it's, you know, to me a little bit on the high side. Salinity 35 parts per thousand, that's normal for this part of the world.
Down below, Tony makes his survey. What he sees are the bleached tips of branching corals. Now, this is normal, part of the growing process of this kind of coral. But he also points out an entire section of coral that is dead. He says the corals were bleached in 1995 and have not recovered. The timing coincides with a major bleaching event that has been well documented in other parts of the Caribbean. Researchers from Texas A&M University have been monitoring the damage on a reef off the coast of Honduras that was bleached in 1995. They believe that the damage was due to an increase in the temperature of the ocean. It's another piece of evidence for scientists who know they can't say for certain that a problem is caused by global warming, but they're also unwilling to risk saying it is not.
To me, the coral reef ecosystem is such a precious bit of our planet that I don't think we can take chances by ignoring possible cause and effect relationships. And I think the evidence is not overwhelming but quite substantial in favor of global warming, and this in turn having an effect on increasing sea temperatures and some of the stresses that we are seeing on coral reefs today.
In years past, Bhawan Singh has come to Trinidad with a group called Earthwatch, a not-for-profit organization that recruits volunteers to help scientists conduct their research. These are his Earthwatch volunteers in June 1994, the beginning of the wet season. Much of Singh's work here surrounds the question of sea level rise, but he knows that there are many other areas of concern for this island if the Earth continues to warm. There's the whole question of what will happen to the weather.
Yes, it's 3.6 now. 3.59.
Singh has looked at the precipitation records for the island, and while highly variable, the records show that over the last 50 years, the dry season has gotten slightly drier, the wet season slightly longer. It's the kind of change that may be expected as temperatures rise.
When we change temperature, we also change the wind patterns, we change the circulation of storm tracks as to where precipitation falls and where it doesn't fall. We begin to change the whole dynamics of weather around the world. Ecosystems are conditioned to the weather in their area. If we moved an ecosystem to a completely different climate, it wouldn't survive. In this case, we're moving a completely different climate to that same ecosystem, and that's going to have a lot of problem dealing with that.
As weather patterns change around the world, one area of concern is agriculture. And in Trinidad, that concern is felt at Carene Limited, the state-owned sugarcane company. Each year, 1.5 million tons of sugarcane are harvested, processed, and much is shipped throughout the world. Mechanical harvesting has been used for the last 35 years, but some fields are off limits to the big machines in order to provide work for manual laborers. Changes in precipitation and the length of growing seasons could affect crop yields. And also, researchers at the plantation are concerned about an increase in pests as warmer, more humid weather becomes the norm. These are the kinds of subtle changes that might be felt in years to come and may go unnoticed by much of the public. But there is one more effect of climate change that is very likely to grab people's attention: the increasing spread of infectious diseases. It's being studied at Harvard University by epidemiologist Paul Epstein.
In Trinidad and throughout the Caribbean and Central America, there has been a blanketing of dengue fever. Dengue fever basically was eliminated in this hemisphere in the 50s, 60s, and 70s. It's come back with a vengeance in the 80s, accelerated in the 90s. 1995, there were over 240,000 cases of dengue fever in the Americas, and some of them fatal.
It's also known as breakbone fever, a severe flu-like illness that's carried by mosquitoes, insects that thrive in the kind of hot, humid weather that will move up in both elevation and in latitude as the earth warms. In some sections of Venezuela, outbreaks have been so severe that entire villages are being fumigated with pesticides. But despite these efforts, the outlook is that diseases like dengue will continue to expand, meaning that tropical diseases may no longer be just a concern for the tropics.
We have had malaria in New Jersey in 1991, in Queens, New York in 1993 during warm, wet summers. 93, you'll remember, was the floods in Mississippi, so that was an extraordinary year. We've had some locally transmitted malaria, and these were locally transmitted by mosquitoes in the area. We've had locally transmitted malaria in Michigan and in Texas. We've had dengue fever in Texas on the border. These are episodic, but they are completely consistent with the model projections that these mosquito-borne diseases can move to higher latitudes with global warming or climate change.
The issue of climate change is incredibly complex. But in Trinidad, people are beginning to understand it through a series of specific concerns, as Bawan Singh literally brings the issue home.
What day come it? January 5th, 6th?
He knows that what he has found is an accumulation of clues, not conclusive evidence of global warming due to increased greenhouse gases. But he also believes that the signals he has identified cannot be ignored.
I think it would be dangerous to wait to have conclusive proof before we act. And that is to see, to begin to adapt to climate change. Climate wouldn't does not wait on politicians to come to any consensus. It is going to follow its course.
In the meantime, Singh is going to be out on the beaches of Trinidad, making the measurements to let the people of this island know just exactly how fast the ocean is coming ashore. For more information about this program, visit the New Explorers at the PBS homepage at pbs.org.
Later tonight, join silver medalist Paul Wiley and